Dario's American Stage family features instrument and patch cables with patented geotip technology, XLR cables with crimped connections, and kill switch cables that prevent onstage noise, giving you the strongest connection available.
Well, I don't mind sleeping alone. If it means I don't have to play your crazy game no more. You're the most precious thing.
Hey, I'm John Bohlinger with Premier Guitar. I'm with Lukas Nelson in the historic Ryman Auditorium in Nashville. Lukas, thank you, man.
All right, nice to meet you.
Yeah, great meeting you. So glad you're here.
Yeah, me too.
Man, let's hear about this Strat, because I remember back in the day seeing you first playing Stratocasters.
Yeah.
And is this like where it all
this
started?
This is the first guitar I ever bought myself.
Cool.
Her name is Christina. She's an American Strat, and she's a workhorse. She's just been around forever, for a long time.
This is a
95 model, but I got this guitar in probably 2000, maybe 6 or 2007.
Huh. Yeah. Some high miles on that thing.
Oh, yeah.
So did you put the humbucker in it?
Yeah, we put that humbucker in there.
Do you know what it is?
I think it's a Rio Grande humbucker. Hager. What kind of humbucker am I using?
That was replaced.
I think it's a Rio Grande.
Yeah, that was replaced.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, it's not the original one. Yeah,
this is Brian Hager. He's my guitar technician. And
it gives a little more
balance. Yeah, that's. I think I got this out of Houston, these Rio Grande pickups.
Oh, yeah, cool. Yeah, cool. So, okay, so what was your first guitar? That's the first one you bought, but what was the first one? You grew up
I actually had a black and white Strat that my mom and dad got me. And then the one that I still have that they got me, I still have that other Strat, which is at the house in Maui, but the other one is, it's another Strat. It's a fat Strat model that they had. And that has a double humbucker on the bridge pickup. And that one really, really growls. We actually put a Rio Grande on that one too. And it really gets going. This looks more like a P90 actually, doesn't it? Or something like.
It looks more like a kind of a PAF kind of.
Yeah, I don't even know what this is, to be honest. Yeah. Wish I was more of a gearhead. it really sounds good. And this is the one I'm letting Logan, our new band member, use it a lot.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah. And but I've had this one for a long time.
Cool. Yeah. Okay, so.
Let's bring the other one out. Yeah.
Yeah, this is the one I've seen you playing, it seems, exclusively for a while now.
Yeah, well, this is the 1956 Les Paul Jr. This has got a P90. I know more about this guitar because this is my main guitar. I use it a lot.
That's great.
When I bought that, I didn't know anything.
Sure.
But when I got this one, Gibson is making my signature model guitar.
Congratulations.
And this is going to be that one, 1956 Les Paul Jr. There's a lot of great features. You can tell the knobs are, this is only done in 1956, the way that it's done like that. And,
that's great.
And it's a beautiful guitar, man. This thing, we got DR strings. Maybe you want to know about that.
Yeah, perfect. Good. Okay, do you know what gauge you run on strings?
Yeah, I mean, I try and run, I think, 11s.
Is
what, you know.
Beefy.
Yeah, but I used to do, because I read a lot about Stevie Ray.
Sure.
When I was a kid, I used to use 13s.
Gosh.
And I just would tear my fingers up.
Yeah,
but
it hurts thinking about it.
But I'm glad I did, because it got my fingers really strong.
Yeah.
And now that I went down to 11s, I have a lot more versatility to it.
Yeah.
Yeah. But the thicker, the better the tone.
Yeah.
You know, so it's good.
So it looks like the bridge maybe has been changed on this to give you a little more intonation. Or is that this?
I think this is the original bridge.
Wow.
Hager, I need you, buddy. That's original. Yeah, I need original bridge. Yeah, yeah.
You know, we've done with it since I've had it. We've had it refretted. Bill Asher in L.A., he refretted it.
Okay, refretted.
Once, maybe twice a year, I change the tuners out because they slip. He's aggressive with it, you know. So
we do have the original.
We do have the original.
Cool.
Yeah.
And a MojoAxe bridge, which I've become a fan of. Jimmy Vivino turned me on.
It
just improved the stability on the intonation. Amazing. I always have a stock of those, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's great. So on the signature, are they going to just basically copy
I've been working with them for months and months now, trying to get it as exact as possible in tribute to this guitar. It's going to be exactly. I mean, I played a few different pickups. They've got the right pickups in there now. It sounds just like it, because I want to be able to play them too and let this one breathe a little bit. Sometimes I feel like it's, you know, I mean, at a certain point, if I'm on the road in the next 30, 40 years, it's going to be 100 years old.
Right, yeah. But
it's still my main guitar, I don't want to not play it. So
that's your trigger.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
You know, so.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Out to us by Gibson too is most guitars wear out.
Speak next to me, so you
get most guitars wear out more up in here. But with Lucas's style, it's tending to wear there from the way he's holding.
Yeah,
it.
I hold it like there. That.
That's
most interesting.
Most of them are kind of wearing down here, up in here. Yeah. So he's getting his own signature on there in that sense.
Yeah,
that's great, man.
Yeah.
Hey, congrats. That's a very cool SIG.
Thanks, man. Let's bring the acoustic over. Yeah.
Okay, so the J200.
Yeah.
God, great.
Yeah, this is a great guitar. This is the Dylan model, actually.
Oh, how cool.
The Bob Dylan model.
Love it.
Yeah.
I love the double scratch.
Yeah,
man.
I mean, it's beautiful. I've seen it. I was actually staying at the Holiday Inn over at Vanderbilt by the stadium.
Yeah.
And on the elevator doors, they've got somebody playing one of these. And I've seen a lot of them. It's pretty funny. There's a plug for you. Holiday Inn. Holiday Inn.
Yeah. Yeah. Give this guy a free room.
Come on. Yeah. Anyways, and this is my dad's signature, because when I first got the guitar, I was on his bus, and I sat it down on the couch, and I left, and I came back, and he had signed it, thinking it was there for an auction.
Oh yeah,
because that's where they put the guitars to sign for the auction. Yeah, so yeah. He just went by it and kind of signed it. But it was great. I got dad's signature on there, which is cool.
Yeah,
and you know, this is a special guitar. It sounds really great, and I'm really stoked.
Such an iconic look too.
Yeah,
man.
Yeah.
And I love these crazy inlays they use.
That's probably Bob's idea. Yeah. I imagine Bob had something to do with the creation of this. It being his model. It's a really, I think it's going to age really well, and you know it's going
to
be
starting to know that it's a guitar.
Yeah.
It's starting to feel it's a guitar.
Yeah. Yeah. No, it's definitely got a personality.
Love it. Okay, cool,
yeah,
man.
Yeah,
and you travel pretty light. I mean, just a couple guitars and
yeah. Well, I got a few guitars. Yeah. And I've got some backups over there.
Yeah.
And we got these two magnetone amps.
Yeah. Let's talk about these magnetones. These have always interested me. They're just such cool. How long have you been running these?
We've been running them for a while now. I don't know, a few years. Ted Kornblum.
Yeah.
Is the guy who runs the magnetone offices. There's the factories down in St. Louis. We went down there. It's all hand wound, incredible stuff. You know, it's just like they made them back then.
Yeah.
And so it really gets that authentic tone. It's got a really great vibrato sound on it.
Right.
And, which I'd like to use.
Yeah, that's great. It's almost like a Leslie. When
it's a very Leslie-like, and it reminds me of like Hendrix back, like in the Band of Gypsies kind of era.
Regrettably, it's a quiet stage right now. They won't let us play. Otherwise, you'd be able to hear this instead of hearing us talking about it.
Yeah.
Trust us.
That.
They're really
come
cool.
Come to the show.
Yeah, come to the show, right.
Come to the next show. Go to promiseoftherreal.com.
Yeah.
Or lukasnelson.com.
Yeah, yeah, these guys are always playing.
Yeah, yeah.
So what are these two models? They're two different ones, right?
The panoramic stereo.
Panoramic stereo.
Two tens in this one.
Panoramic.
Yeah,
two
that's
tens.
Two tens and that's 212s.
212s
right?
And the stereo Twilighter.
Yeah.
Stereo that's their kind of like flagship.
The yeah, that's Twilighter. The stereo. Yeah, that's the good one. Well, they're both great for the road.
The big boy, the little brother.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Balance it out. What you have on this side is our lower end. That's more of the volume and the girth. You know, the balls.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This one, the smaller speakers, you push those tubes and we get the growl that we want. You know?
Yeah.
So it's a nice combination.
Yeah.
Yeah. Cool. And it really, yeah, we run them stereo. And I've been running, honestly, without any distortion at all, except just the last few shows, I put this blues driver in there And it gets a little more crunch, but honestly, I run most of my shows straight through the amps. I just go straight from the amps into that guitar.
That's great.
I have a little tuner, and that's it. And yeah. I don't really like a lot of pedals. I get that blues driver for a little growl, but it's a real nice raw, just visceral sort of sound.
Sure.
And it really breaks up well when you got this set up here. It's pretty cool.
Are you running pretty loud or?
What do we have it on most of the time?
It depends on the room. It's outside. You know, we kind of crank
this is
them.
This is where they are right there.
Yeah. I kind of keep it in there. It goes in and out of our markers.
It looks about like four. It's like three or four right there, you know. We don't really need to blow them out.
I mean, loud enough to have a baffle on that side to protect.
Yeah, them. Anthony gets blown out sometimes, so he likes to have that baffle there. Yeah. But cool. You know.
And this this radial just lets you split between.
Yeah, that's just a splitter. Yeah.
Yeah.
So you can. I have them running at the same time though.
Yeah.
I just have them have it so they're connected and they run it, you know, and in case I ever wanted to just turn one off or.
Right.
Or
it's clean business, man.
Yeah, it's clean.
Guitar,
living. Yeah.
Amp,
yeah.
Loud.
Oh yeah, and people, I don't know, people love it. Like, you know, it's. I don't know. I'm not like, you know, Marcus King. I mean, he's an amazing guitar player, but I, you know, I think that I've got a style that works for me, and I'm, you know, I like to, I mean, people. I also feel like. I can play whatever I want with this setup. Like I could do the Hendrix thing or I could do that kind of thing, but I like just going through. I like Neil's tone. I like Neil Young.
Oh God,
you know?
Yeah, amazing.
I like Neil's.
I like everything about that dude.
Yeah, me too. You know, I like that he's more like Dad. It's like you kind of don't know where he's going, and then he ends up somewhere amazing, and it's it's incredible. You
it's
know?
Like
it's very lyrical and.
And at times, it's like a cat falling off a roof, man. You're like, it's not going to land on its feet. Oh, it did.
It did. And, you know, the other guy that's probably my favorite guitar player is J.J. Cale.
Yeah, yeah.
And just, it's all about tone. And that's what magnetones really, you know, I love them. And Neil uses these magnetones.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Wow. And Dad uses a Baldwin amp, which is very similar. Yeah.
That same, one forever.
It's got a similar sort of feel, too, as these magnetones. It's that type of sort of thing. That's my setup.
Yeah, perfect. Well, man, congrats. You guys are killing it.
Thank you.
Check them out on the road. They are never not playing.
Yeah, or we're at your farmer's market, your local farmer's market.
That's true. They're there today. Yeah, dude,
We do. We like to bring farmers, local growers in the area to the show. Sometimes we'll do a pop-up farmer's market, like in Kansas City and in Wilmington. We had 1,000 people in Wilmington come, and there were 7 vendors, and they all came, you know, 6 hours before the show, and it was great. We did a little performance there, and then all our fans get to see that in their local areas, alternatives to Walmart or Target or something, they can go to a mom and pop place and really support it.
Isn't that cool? I mean, that's so cool because, I mean, the whole farm aid thing 25, 30 years ago, it's cool to see just like that tradition carried on in a practical way. That's
exactly.
Great,
yeah.
Man.
Well, it's kind of like a rolling farm aid.
Yeah.
And that's our way of kind of giving back at the same time.
Yeah.
You know.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
Beautiful. I like that. Social consciousness, people.
Yeah. Okay. Right on,
thanks,
man.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah, of course.
All right, here I'm with Corey McCormick. Corey, thanks for joining us, man.
Thanks for having me.
So you're touring with one bass.
I am. You know, really out of just there wasn't any room.
Yeah.
And we don't have it really like dedicated text to each individual guy. And it just was easier. I have another bass on the bus.
Yeah.
Just in case, like if I snap a string, it's go get the other bass.
Yeah.
But this is my workhorse. I love this bass. It sounds killer.
What is it?
It's a Yamaha BB bass. This 2024.
Wow, to me.
The number on it.
What year is this bass?
That's a good question.
It looks oldish.
It is oldish. It's not. I don't think it's quite like in 80s or anything that old.
Yeah.
Maybe, but in the 80s they didn't have both. They were all one neck, one piece.
Huh.
But they've given me a few basses. I've been working with Yamaha for since 2012. I played with a Japanese artist and just kind of worked out to hook up with Yamaha.
Yeah.
And I love their basses. I love how it's the PJ setup and I can get a really warm, full sound and playing in various areas on the neck here. And then, you know, I can go to this back pickup and get a really tight, like, Jocko-ish, which I love to, like, try to sound like Jocko.
Sure.
He's an idol of mine.
Yeah, who wouldn't want to sound like Jocko?
I like having that at my disposal for, like, soloing and that kind of stuff. You know, and it's good to have the versatility of the two. And just having one bass, I need to be able to get a couple different tones out of one thing.
Sure. And you're running flat wounds.
Yes, sir.
I wasn't
initially a flat wound guy. I mean, I was like a funk. I played upright bass first.
Yeah.
I started bass later. I've been playing music my whole life, but I started playing bass in my 20s, and it was upright only. So I did start with flats because it's an upright thing.
Yeah.
But when I started electric bass, it was all round wounds just because I was doing a lot of jazzy, funky things and popping and that kind of stuff. But I started with flat wounds a few years back, just experimenting with different tones and things. And I put flats on. I had rounds on this, and I put the flats on, and it just sang. It was just like, whole. It just meant to have flats. It just sounds killer. The tone is, it's just rad. I don't know. I don't know how to describe it.
What brand are you using?
These are DR strings. Both Lucas and I are endorsed with DR. They only have one set of flat wounds, so it's just their standard flat wound set.
And it looks like you did a hip shot drop on that.
I did. That's another, you know, having one bass if all of a sudden he goes into a song, because sometimes that happens.
Sure.
And it's in a drop D tuning, I can just go, oh, sick.
Yeah,
and I'm there. And I started doing that with Neil. Actually, I used these, I played with Chris Cornell for 3 years, and I had hip shots on all the basses for the same reason, because it could just all of a sudden be a drop D tune.
Yeah.
And a lot of times I'd end a song and I'd be way over on the stage, because we'd be on like big, huge stages, and I didn't want to have to run way back to tune or do whatever, so I could just go
quick, you know. Flip.
Yeah. So this is my baby. I'm working with Yamaha to like reproduce this.
Cool.
And make some improvements, but it's the stock pickups. For some reason, these just sound better than any of the other ones I've played.
There's no
describing it. Yeah. No one can describe it to me at Yamaha. I've asked a lot of questions, but it's all mysterious, very Japanese, you know, which is cool. But I love it, man. It's been a great bass, and I love the neck and everything about it. I love the size.
Yeah, it almost looks like a jazz kind of neck, like narrowish.
Uh-huh. It's not as big as, you know, as some...
Like a P
or
something.
Like a P could be.
Yeah.
And, you know, I got smaller hands, but, so that's, smaller's better. I'm getting a short scale from Gibson today, actually.
Oh, cool.
They're bringing me to try out, so.
Yeah. Cool.
I'll have that bass later. I wish it had gotten
Yeah,
here,
wish it was here, yeah.
Yeah, well.
Sorry to get here earlier, Gibson.
Sorry, Gibson, but I am going to have it, and I will probably be playing it, so you'll see it maybe later. But that's the bass.
Okay, cool. Let's talk about your amp back here.
So all Aguilar gear. I've been working with Aguilar now for a few years. Again, because of the lack of space and how we were traveling before, we're starting to be able to grow now, but I had to go small. And what I like to do is run two amps, and I run all my effects to one side.
Oh, do a dry, wet kind of thing?
And so I always have a dry, fat sound, my sound happening. And then I just add on top of that, which just creates a really big, fat, huge sound.
Cool.
There's some things that you have to, you know, phasing and things you have to be aware of, and it's a little bit, you know, a pain in the ass. You got to work it out. But I'm starting to really dial it in with these little dudes. It's starting to really sound good.
Yeah, what are they? One's the...
So this is 410. These are the SL cabinets.
Okay.
410s and 212.
Okay.
I'm running all the effects through the 12s just because I figure it's more like a guitar kind of thing, and the reason why I started doing that initially was because a lot of overdrives for bass suck your low end out. And even if they have an EQ, it's just weird. I don't know, I've always had, I never really liked it. And so I started experimenting with this setup, mainly to be able to add like really dirty drive and still have that low end bass happening.
Good idea.
You know, I roll a lot of low ends off this side of things, and it's more of a guitar setup. But when it's blended together, it's pretty cool.
Yeah, and the two amps are, one's an AG 700 and the other one's a Tonehammer 700?
Tonehammer 700. I think this is new to them. They just released this. I just got this
from
them.
Which is the dry?
This is my dry.
Okay.
So I used to have a 500.
Yeah.
So I usually run whatever the smaller thing is to the effects, just so I have a lot of headroom and big sound with my regular sound.
Cool.
I'm hoping to upgrade now that we have more room. You know, when I play with Neil, I have two 751 big dudes.
A little more room.
And then a 612 and a 610 cabinet.
Yeah.
So it's more.
Moonlight air.
Yeah. You know.
Yeah.
more bass. But this is like bass light. But it works.
Yeah.
You know, and we don't play in really huge places usually with just our band yet. Hopefully we're trying to grow. But, you know, and it's been good for lately, as of late.
Great.
Been enjoying it.
Well, actually, let's talk about this pedal board then.
Right.
That's a good segue.
Yeah.
Okay. So you're running a hard cable into the chromatic tuner.
Tuner,
and
yes.
And then from there?
Tuner goes to the Noble, which is a preamp type of situation.
Yeah.
We can use as a DI as well, clean DI if I wanted to. And I just like having that there because I can add EQ or, you know, I can get a little more out of it.
Sure.
A little more gain.
And
just because of how I have my setup, ideally I'd like to have this running at the end, I think. But I put it in the beginning because I want it to hit both the clean sound and the dirty sound.
You can tweak both amps with one.
Right.
Yeah.
And then once I have my volumes and everything set and someone's like, oh, can you turn up? All I have to do is go wonk and my whole mix just goes up.
Sure.
Right? Or turn down, whatever. If I'm hearing like I need less low end on everything, I can do it all here.
Yeah, that's clean. Yeah.
And it affects both amps. And then from the Noble, we go to the switcher, you know, this radial amp switcher, which I started using this recently because this has a polarity switch on it.
Yeah, so the phasing issues and stuff like that.
I was starting to notice that they weren't in phase, you know, and so we put this in the line and now we can dial it in.
That's so practical because there's sometimes you're just wondering, is that, you know, because it's sometimes phasing is so weird.
You know what's weird is I've been doing a lot of stuff in the studio lately, like at home. When I get home, I'm like in the studio, I'm working on this project of mine right now. And because I'm working on mixing, I can hear it phasing now so much better because I've been working on that in the studio. And so now I know exactly what I'm listening for. At least it's better. Before I wasn't even thinking about it.
Yeah.
Honestly.
But now with one flip of the switch.
Boom. And it has a ground lift on it.
Yeah.
So, and this is AB, like, you know, this is clean and dirty. And then
both.
This is everything together.
Perfect. Okay.
And then from there, that swings up to the discombobulator, which is like an envelope, you know, kind of thing. And then that swings up to the POG, which is an octave divider. It gives you a lower octave and a higher octave, and you can tweak those. And then I have a chorus. This thing is incredible. This is a friend of mine in Japan, FAT. He was a guitar tech, like the main tech for this band that I worked for over there, this huge, massive band, and he makes gear, and I needed a chorus pedal, and he gave me this, and I keep telling him, send me more, because
that's great.
It's awesome. I love it. And then that goes to the distortion next. This is my overdrive, the Wampler.
Okay.
Just something that I've been trying out. And then I use the Eventide for a little delay kind of thing. We have the little mini bass wah and a little reverb.
It's great, man. That's a lot of stuff. That's a lot of like sonic options, you know?
It's fun.
Yeah, yeah. And this is all about fun.
It's so much fun. I have a lot. Yeah. I mean, it's interesting to have all this stuff being in like a country, whatever band. I don't think we're country. We're getting labeled that now. I think we're more rock and roll, but you know. And initially this was birthed out of, we were just a trio when I first joined the band, and it was like, I need to fill up space.
Yeah.
You know, I need to fill in not only the low end, but I was doing like wah stuff and just like make it sound like a guitar.
Yeah.
Just to fill it up.
Yeah.
And now I'm trying to use it in more subtle ways because we have Logan doing all everything that he's doing now, which is, you know, lightens my load, and I can just play bass instead of putting all these fills and trying to do a bunch of extra work.
But when you want to.
But it's there when I want it. Yeah.
Yeah. It's cool. Well, hey, man. Yeah. Pleasure meeting you.
Same.
Congrats. Yeah.
Thank you very much. Thanks, guys.